2019 marks the 50th anniversary of Elvis Presley's legendary recording sessions at Memphis's own American Sound Studio.
And songs like In the Ghetto and Suspicious Minds and many others not only had the touch of the King of Rock and Roll, but American Sound's house band, also known as the Memphis Boys. And here with us this morning, two members of that iconic group, Mr. Bobby Wood and Mr. Gene Chrisman. Gentlemen, welcome. Glad to have you here in Memphis.
Thank you.
For me, when I look back on especially those just legendary years of this superb music that came out, I want to know, how did you guys come into the fold? Because this was like an all-star band and some of the best musicians around. How were you picked?
Chip Smallman was a guy that had worked for Stax.
Okay.
He was brilliant.
He had recorded Carla Thomas and several other groups there, you know. And he had left there and bought a place or rented a place over on Thomas and Chelsea. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And so I worked at Phillips Studio at the time with Sam Phillips and different people there. And Sam had the only lathe in town that people could come by and make their masters and then take them down to the plant in Mississippi. Mm-hmm. And so I met Cropper and Chips and different people that came in there with that, you know, because I was staff player, and Gene was staff drummer too at that point.
Incredible.
So when Elvis first came in the studio to perform, and do you remember a moment where you were just like, okay, this guy's got something, or was he already big? I mean, he had, what was your reaction when he first came in?
At the time, he hadn't had a record in 7 years. Mm.
So you thought he was kind of not irrelevant?
Worked around the clock, so we didn't have any knowledge of that.
You were just doing your thing.
You're just trying to put food on the table.
Just glad to be there. And tried to sleep in between cuts.
Yeah, so you weren't like overly impressed or what until he came in? What was that moment like?
Well, you know, it's just, he brought a bunch of guys in, and Chips just went ahead and got them out of the studio, because you can't work around a bunch of people that's hanging out.
You're absolutely right. Yeah.
If you do that, you never will get anything recorded, you know. So Chips got them out, and we went on to work, and it was fun. You know, we had a good time doing it, and Elvis was nice to us, and we tried to be nice to him, you know.
Yeah.
Just anybody that came in, it didn't make any difference who it was.
Yeah, right, he was just there to do
we
a job.
We treated them all
it.
The same.
Got you covered. So, Bobby, once you got going, and again, once you guys really started recording some of this music, were there some of those songs there, even for you and Gene as well, that you said, wait a minute, I think we got something here? Or did you have any idea, or was there a gut feeling?
Well, you know, their publishing people brought a bunch of acetates in. I mean, it was a stack like this, you know, and some of the publishing guys was dancing, and back in those days we was calling it boogalooing or down, you know. It's like to nothing. I mean it was nothing, George Klein came over to me, and we was all sitting around with our heads in our hands, because at this time we'd had 72 chart records in four different charts.
Wow.
And we were pretty familiar with hit songs.
I would say so.
You could identify them like
so
that.
George said, Bobby Wood said, what do you think about these songs? And I said, personally, I think they're a bunch of crap, you know?
Did you really?
George
true story?
George turned around and said, Elvis, Bobby Wood said, I said, thank you, George. And I didn't know where he was going to kick me out or what.
But Suspicious Minds, was it one of those that turned out?
That was one of our songs.
Wow. So, how did that happen then? Did they say,
a big deal on that.
Yeah, tell us.
Mark James, you know, wrote the song. Uh-huh.
And recorded it.
We had recorded it one time on Mark. But anyway, they brought this guy in from Hill and Range, and they was wanting to have publishing. That's when it all started. Mm-hmm. Chip said, they got into it, and Chip said, I'll tell you what, you're not getting half publishing. And he said, what you can do, he said, you can just go ahead and take Elvis, and y'all can go ahead and get out, because you're not getting half public. He'd run him off, and we cut the song.
Really?
I had no idea it happened like that. Really?
Yes, sir. Chip stood up. He said, you're not getting publishing.
Wow.
And they didn't get publishing. We cut the song. It was the first record he'd had in, big record he had in over 7 years.
Wow.
That was
wow.
the last biggest record.
Good for Chips.
Yeah. Well, I mean, you know, we were like a production group, you know, by this time. And it was like, why would we want to just cut a bunch of nothing songs again?
Right.
Because
you didn't need it,
no,
basically.
No, and we weren't going to do that, you know. And one of Felton Jarvis asked me, he said, I appreciate if you wouldn't speak up and say anything derogatory here about the songs or anything. And I said, well, don't ask me. Somebody ask me, okay?
Don't ask me.
I'm going to tell you what I think.
Always. Well, Bobby,
well, that's the only way you
can
get a hit record cut sometimes.
That's,
you know, you can't put out a bunch of junk. And I understand Elvis didn't care for some of the stuff he'd recorded and some of the movies he did, you know?
Yeah.
They didn't have any hit songs any longer in their publishing company.
Sure.
So, but we had Kentucky Rain. We had... Don't Cry Daddy. We had Suspicious Minds in the Ghetto.
In the Ghetto.
Mac
great
Davis
song.
Played in the ghetto in person. You know,
that is amazing. Gentlemen,
well,
we appreciate everything that you have done, and we appreciate you being here this morning.
Thank you
for
very
coming
much.
Back to Memphis.
Thank you.
Good to see you both. Thank you, Bobby.
You
thank
too.
You.